Who's got the right to tell you that you're not allowed to take something that grows on Earth, like our planet? We're not allowed to smoke cannabis or whatever, you know?
You take it, whatever you're taking, whether it's alcohol or cigarettes or anything. And when you're taking it, you get a kick out of it. And then when that kick's gone, you feel, you know, the same as you were, and you feel that you want to go back to it just to become happy again or whatever. You know, it's not that your body actually needs it, it's just your mind.
Don't do this and don't do that. You're dying to know what, why and I. And you take it just to see what it's like. And then when you find you get a hiss out of it, will you get more of a hiss out of it when you take more and more and that? And that's how you get it.
OK, well, before we actually start playing the film, I work for an organisation called Lifeline Project, which has been in the field of drug use for about 9 years. And one of the things that we've found in all that time is that the majority of films done on drugs are sort of very much like drugs will kill you, drugs will degrade you, this is what's going to happen. And they're all sort of very, very scary. And most young kids actually enjoy doing things that are dangerous. I mean, that's why kids throw bangers around. And that's why kids sort of play chicken on the motorway, you know. OK, so... All right, the film shows the story of a bloke who has used a particular drug to fill in an important gap in his life. In this case, it's heroin, but it could have been barbiturates, it could have been Valium, it could have been booze.
A new entry at number 37, an exciting sound from the RUTS, it's Babylon's Burning!
Babylon's burning, you'll burn the street, you'll burn your houses with anxiety.
Malcolm Owen, lead singer with the RUTS, died of a heroin overdose on July the 14th, 1980, aged 26. The band had split 2 weeks before.
If we'd got the phone call like 2 or 3 months before, then maybe we would have, like, it wouldn't have been such a shock. But like, seeing as we saw him the last time, and he was great, you know, he was just
it was really great.
And it, like, when we got the phone call, I thought, well, you know, my immediate reaction was like, I hope. Because we'd split the band up, he hadn't done it, hadn't killed himself on purpose. Because there was no, at the time, it was nothing at the time to say that what it was. You know what I mean? Yeah. All we got was a phone call saying that, you know.
Mick, you found Malcolm's body. Can you tell me what happened?
I called around to see him, take him for a drink that afternoon, and he was meant to be in the bath, and there was some difficulty getting hold of him, like he wasn't answering, and we shouted to him. So eventually I broke the door in and I found him there in the bath, and well, that's all, really. It's not a lot more to say.
How long had you known Malcolm?
Let me see, about 13 years.
Had you always been close?
Yeah, really close. I've been away with him to various parts of the world, different occasions. I'd live with him on 2 or 3 occasions, different localities. I've always been really good friend with him, you know, as long as I can remember.
Had he been involved with drugs before he got into rock music?
Ever since I'd known him, he'd been smoking dope, maybe taking acid, LSD. He did have a period when he was addicted to heroin before he got into rock music, and he seemed to have got out of that okay.
Why do you think he needed it? Why did he take it?
I don't know, really. I mean, like, it's a difficult question, really. He seemed to turn to it when he was lacking in... when there wasn't anyone to give him, I don't know, love, give him give him a cuddle if you like, you know, like always when he was without either his mother or the woman he loved, he seemed to turn to heroin, I think. The only times I've known him turn to heroin, like he was away from the lady that he really loved.
Of our success in Malcolm, there's a certain amount of problems that we didn't have because he's the lead singer. He gets a lot more of the attention, interviews, people always want to talk to him, young girls always want to see him. And at the same time, in being married, it did cause a lot more conflict in his life, more than it did us three. And then his wife, Rocky, a very lovely lady, decided to leave, which left a big hole in his life. And heroin is, unfortunately, is a thing that in some people fills that hole, which I think it did to him, unfortunately.
When you knew that he was back on heroin, did you try to get him off it?
Yeah, for sure. We had, like, many talks and arguments and fights about the whole scene. He was always trying to get me to do it with him and things like that. I'm no angel, but I don't think I'm stupid either. I don't think Malcolm was stupid, but there was something in him that led him down that path, you know? And it didn't matter what I said, it didn't matter what the boys said, it didn't matter what anybody said. He was his own man, he was going to do what he wanted. I suppose he thought he could handle it.
You don't really notice and you don't really have that much sort of, what's it?
You don't suss it out so much because
Until it's too late.
Yeah, right.
And then, I mean, then we did. I mean, we used to have blind. I mean, in this very room, we used to have blinding rows. You know, like just trying to get across to Malcolm that he was killing himself.
It was too late.
Yeah. It's a terrible drug. I mean, it's got such velvet claws. You don't know. I mean, people who know people and the actual person who's doing it don't know how bad it is until it's too late.
Do you think he felt ashamed of his dependence, that he knew he was screwing things up?
Yeah, I think he was... He knew he was letting the rest of the band down as well as himself, you see, because like the band had such a terrific momentum going for them and it is all squandered. And now they've got virtually to start again from scratch. Did Malcolm change as a person after he developed this dependence? Radically, he changed a lot. From always used to be smiling, always used to be chatting, having a good time, and quiet. He went on the last tour, and all the rest of the band would be the same, and he'd be sitting up the front of the van, not speaking to anyone. He'd totally changed, withdrawn.
It's really weird, because heroin really affects the person that's taking it, but sort of at the same time, it really affects everyone. Everyone that's around them, you know, like us two, you know what I mean? I was sharing a room with him and all that. And, like, really does you in, gives you a lot of strain. Because I was trying to get him off it and all that, but, like, no, it's not as easy as that.
Yeah. I think what heroin seems to do is like take away all your sort of what you call your humanity, you know what I mean?
Your love.
What everyone claims as to being you, you know what I mean? Like the sort of character and the personality you are. And they took away that more than anything, you know what I mean? Because he was really, really quiet and introvert, you know what I mean? Rather than his extrovert type self, which he usually was. And we noticed it this year, you know, like, It was worse this year, the last tour we done, but we had to cancel the last few days, if you can do it. At the same time, he had a dodgy throat, you know.
But, I mean, the general feeling on that tour was, I mean, it wasn't the same as any other tour we'd done because Malcolm had a problem, had a habit. I mean, he'd be the first one to go to bed at night time, so he wouldn't be joining in the fun after the gig. He'd be the last one to get up in the morning, sit in the front of the van, sort of, you know, quiet all the way to the gig, and it weren't the same spirit that we've been working in, you know what I mean? It's just, yeah, like it made the three of us like here, and Malcolm was over there. I mean, it just made him a loner in every sense.
Mick, did Malcolm try to kick the habit? A lot of his lyrics and his songs seem to suggest that he was struggling.
Yeah, like I'm sure he tried. Well, I know he tried at least three or four times to actually stop taking it with varying amounts of success. Sometimes he'd stop for 2 days and start again. Other times he'd stop for maybe a whole week. Love in Vain was actually written during one of these times, and when he decided that he would actually stop. We were both laid out on the carpet, sort of, and he came up with the line, like, too much time I'm spending on my back, and I don't want to do it anymore, you know. And it came from there. His idea, like, he was going to stop, and the song just happened from his idea that he was going to stop. But it didn't last, you know. It lasted maybe 8-9 days, and then he was back. When he died, I mean, he had actually stopped, I'm sure, for maybe 10 days, 12 days before then, and that was the first time he'd been back to it, and it killed him.
I think the thing that really sickens me, one of the things that really sickens me about the music press and the whole rock and roll image is the way they glorify drugs. I mean, that sort of drug, the whole thing about, oh, the glamorous junkie, the Keith Richards wasted look, all that sort of thing, the silver noses and that, it's really sick, because there's nothing glamorous at all about heroin. It's nasty, it does kill people, and that's all there is to it.
Did you split the band to try and get him off?
Well, it weren't so much to try and get him off. I mean, we'd done everything we can. We had arguments with him, we'd just down, you know, just said, you're still doing it, you know, and he'd say, no. Until in the end, where we just couldn't work with him no more, because, I mean, he was always just that, not on the same wavelength as it was. We just said, you know, like, we're leaving. The three of us left the Ruts, as it were, and left Malcolm. So, I mean, we did split the band, but I don't think it was so much to get him off of it. Although, what in fact happened was he did stop using it for like 2 weeks. Up yeah. to 2 weeks before his before he died, he did clean up totally.
Yeah, I'll bet it.
Yeah, because what happened?
So it was. It did work.
Yeah, I mean, we used to have lots of scenes, didn't we? But the final time, we all decided that we just couldn't work together anymore. And like, it was in here actually, and we were. Sort of each of us sort of just had a really good heart to heart with him. It's more than we had done for months, you know what I mean? About why we wanted to, because we all had different reasons why we thought we should, you know, sort of knock it on the head. And after that, I mean, that seemed to do the trick, you know, for Malcolm, because he, like Paul said, he was cleaning up. And in fact, we met him like on the Wednesday before he died, about 4 days before he died.
We went out for a drink, it was great. It was yeah, he was just like old days.
Yeah, I mean, he was a bit ill, you know, because but he was cleaning up. And he, you know, he had his sense of humour and
he laughed, which was very unusual.
And, you know, we were even going to do his first solo single with him and things like that. But he never. Then on the Monday, of course, died. A doomy phone call, you see.